Thank you. That concludes general questions. The next item of business is First Minister's questions. At question number one, I call Russell Finlay.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The SNP's plans for a national care service have already wasted £28 million of taxpayers' money. Four parliamentary committees have warned about its flaws. NHS bosses have serious concerns. Scotland's council leaders and unions have pooled their support. So why is the First Minister pushing ahead with a plan that nobody seems to want?
First Minister.
Before I answer the substance of Russell Finlay's question, may I welcome him to his post as leader of the Scottish Conservative and Unionist Party, and look forward to these exchanges, which will take their course over the next few weeks, months and years. On the question of the National Care Service, the National Care Service is a product of consultation and dialogue with members of the public, led by the Feely Review. And the Feely Review concluded that there was such variation in the quality of social care and the effectiveness of social care around the country that there was an argument and a necessity for there to be a national care service to make sure that wherever individuals are in the social care sector in the country, they are able to receive the highest quality of support. That is the foundation behind the National Care Service, and it's on that basis that the Government will pursue the proposition that we've put forward to Parliament.
So, Finlay.
I thank the First Minister for his kind words, and I look forward to our exchanges. I've counted 60 until Election Day, but what I really hope for from the First Minister is some answers. One in five care homes have closed over the past decade, and the NHS is paying the price, with almost 2,000 people trapped in hospitals, which is the highest on record. First Minister, Scotland's care sector is collapsing today. Yep. People need action today. Every penny should be spent helping them today, not wasting years on yet another SNP pet project that is doomed to fail. So why can't the First Minister see that?
First Minister.
It's for many of the reasons that Mr Finlay puts to me that I support a national care service, because I am very, very concerned about the level of delayed discharge in our hospitals today. And it's been the focus of significant attention from me as First Minister and the Health Secretary and his ministerial team and those acting on our behalf. Let me just give Mr Finlay an illustration of why this is a problem in the country. Apart from the fact that there are nearly 2,000 people who are delayed in leaving hospital at this present moment, and we've been putting in sustained efforts, and I think the situation would have been significantly worse had we not done so. But today, per 100,000 of population in each local authority area in the country, the number of delayed discharges ranges from 9.3 in one local authority area to 108 in another, 10 times the difference. So if one local authority area can secure a delayed discharge level of 9.3 per 100,000 of the population, I ask myself, why is there a position which is 10 times worse at the other end of the spectrum? That is unfair in this country. It needs to be addressed, and that's what a National Care Service will deliver.
Russell Finlay.
The First Minister's own figures reveal that this is a today problem, and it's classic SNP, wasting time and money, neglecting what people really need. Yes. Government ministers yet again grabbing power from local communities. The National Care Service will cost billions of pounds, and that's just to set up. So how will another expensive, bloated and wasteful quango help anyone?
First Minister. Well,
one of the factors that Mr Finlay will be calculating in his cost assessment that he's just put on the record today is the fact that as part of this exercise we intend to increase the pay and remuneration for social care workers around the country. And no wonder Mr Finlay objects to that, because the Conservatives have objected to every attempt on our part to improve pay for social care workers the length and breadth of the country. So I can assure Mr Finlay that at this present moment there is significant pressure being applied to improve the delayed discharge position in local authority areas where it is poor. And we maintain that pressure on a constant basis. It occupies a huge amount of my attention and that of the Health Secretary as First Minister. Some areas are improving, but not nearly fast enough. So if we have a situation where in one local authority area it is possible for there to be only 9.3 members of the public in delayed discharge per 100,000, how is it justifiable for there to be 10 times that amount in any other part of the country? That's why we need a national care service.
Russell Finlay.
This really does sum up what's wrong with politics in Scotland. Plans for a national care service that are costing a fortune, but not caring for anyone, just like the ferries that don't carry passengers and prisoners that free criminals early. This government needs a reality check. It's become disconnected from the people it's supposed to represent, like the thousands who are in need of care today.
Yes.
Surely it's basic common sense to ditch the SNP's National Care Service plan and just put the money directly into frontline care.
First Minister.
This government is investing in our social care system and investing in the provision of care services throughout this country in a more significant way than is provided for by the financial allocations made to Scotland by the United Kingdom government. Now, Mr Finlay, of course, was a supporter of Liz Truss. We can...
Carry on, First Minister, members.
The Conservatives obviously don't like being reminded that Mr Finlay... The Conservatives...
We will hear the First Minister. Many members wish to put questions today. I'd like us to continue. First Minister.
The Conservatives obviously don't like hearing that Mr Finlay was a supporter of Liz Truss, whose economic and fiscal policies have undermined the public finances of Scotland. That is the reality that I'm going to point out to Mr Finlay. And what this government has done is it's taken the hard decisions to invest more in our public services, more in our health and social care services, than would have been the case if we had followed the United Kingdom government's budget allocations to Scotland. £1.5 billion more invested in our public services. So if Mr Finlay wants a lesson in reality, I will tell him that I will not follow the discredited and failed policies of the Conservative Party. We will make our choices here in Scotland to invest in our public services and to protect the people of our country.
Question number two, Anna Sarwar.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. For years, we have known that delayed discharge is exacerbating the crisis in our NHS. Delayed discharge is when someone is medically cleared to leave hospital but is unable to do so due to a lack of a care package. Almost a decade and countless health ministers ago, the SNP promised to eradicate this dangerous practice. But new figures show that on average 2,000 patients were needlessly stuck in hospital every day in August, the highest number ever on record. That's the equivalent of every bed in NHS Lothian or every bed in Ninewells, Ragmore, Wishaw and Inverclyde hospitals combined. And more than £1.3 billion has been lost to delayed discharge since the SNP promised to eradicate it in February 2005. So why has this SNP government spectacularly failed to tackle this crisis?
First Minister.
As Mr Sarwar will know, there has been a significant increase in demand on our health and care services as a consequence of the COVID pandemic. That's the reality of what we are wrestling with. What the government has done in addressing that reality is that we have increased social care spending by 25%. We've delivered on our programme for government commitment to increase social care spending by 25% over this Parliament, 2 years ahead of our original target. So we've put in the extra resources because we were prepared to take the hard decision on tax to increase public investment and to increase public expenditure. Now, I don't in any way diminish or dismiss the significance of the problem of delayed discharge. I've recounted, I've put on the record, the disparity of performance around the country, which is a source of great concern to me in the performance of health and social care partnerships around the country. But what the government has done is invested in the system to ensure that we can support the system and deliver on expectations. But we face the higher demand as a consequence of COVID.
Anna Sarwar.
What the First Minister fails to do is measure outcomes of what's happening actually in our health and social care system. And this is a government that on outcomes has a track record of failure with devastating consequences, record levels of delayed discharge on this government's watch. Now, Scottish Labour has called for a national care service for more than a decade. And we actually welcomed when this government finally agreed to support one. But we also warned that it had to be more than a slogan. And half a decade later, and the SNP's plans are now in disarray. The fact is that their plans are just a national care service in name only that does nothing to actually fix the problem, fund a single extra care worker, or improve services. It's why care unions, councils and NHS leaders are now withdrawing support and raising concerns. The SNP's plans could now cost £2.2 billion. Surely this money should be spent on care packages, additional workers, better paying conditions and actually reducing delayed discharge.
First Minister.
That is precisely what the government is doing, because I've just put on the public record that the government has increased social care spending by 25%, which was our target, and we've delivered that early. Now, members of Parliament have to accept that we have to operate within a budget that's agreed by this Parliament. Within the commitments we've made, we have increased social care expenditure so that care workers are paid more, which they are, so that we have more care workers employed, which we do, to make sure that we can deliver that care. But there is a challenge about rising demand, which is why the delayed discharge figure is so high, and we have variation in the performance between different areas in the country. So those are the realities that we are wrestling with. But what will not help us is if we reduce public expenditure or we don't have continued investment in the service. And of course, Mr. Sarwar represents a position now which wants to change the position that we have on tax. He does not support the extra investment that we've generated out of tax decisions. And Mr. Sarwar supports a United Kingdom government that is carrying on with austerity. We've got to break out of this austerity cycle. We need investment. This government is committed to it. I don't think Mr. Sarwar is.
Anna Sarwar.
Mr. The First Minister just does not live in reality, and he is not accepting that outcomes are getting worse for people in Scotland on this government's watch. And he can try and spin the facts and blame all the others that he wants, but the truth is that his plan is an absolute disaster. Workers don't want it. Experts don't want it, and warnings have been ignored for years. Their botched plans are just a power grab that will waste money, won't improve care, and won't address delayed discharge, which is a key factor in the NHS crisis. We support a proper national care service, but as always with this government, no good idea ever survives their incompetence. So will the First Minister wake up to the reality in our NHS and care service, ditch this costly, unworkable bill, and bring forward a credible alternative plan to fix the crisis they have created?
First Minister.
I'm interested in all that Mr. Sarwar said today. Unless I misheard him, I don't think at any stage did he talk about service users.
Exactly.
Because service users want a national care service.
Yeah.
That's who wants a national care service. Because they are deeply concerned by the issues. They are deeply concerned by the issues that we are working to wrestle with. Now, What I'd say to Mr Sarwar is the government will engage constructively with all interested parties about the establishment of a national care service, because we want to improve outcomes for members of the public. We are committed to doing exactly that, and we will engage constructively with the Labour Party and with anybody else about their ideas about taking forward the national care service. But what we have to be aware of is that when members of Parliament come here demanding investment in our public services, they have to be prepared to support the means to make that happen. Now, that doesn't happen if members of Parliament come here and oppose what we are doing on tax. It does not happen if members of Parliament, as Mr Sarwar told me during the election campaign, say there will be no austerity and then deliver austerity in the United Kingdom government. That does not add up. That will not meet the needs of patients in our country. That will not deliver on the better outcomes for people in our country.
Question number three, Patrick Harvey.
The world's failure to address Israel's impunity, to protect civilians or to prevent war crimes has made escalation of violence in the Middle East inevitable. And through devolved funding decisions, the Scottish Government does have a role here. There have been far too many deaths. The brutal killings on October the 7th, genocide inflicted on the people of Gaza, and the bombardment and invasion of Lebanon, and now the world faces an imminent threat of full-scale regional war. We need immediate ceasefire in Gaza and de-escalation in the wider region, but the Prime Minister continues to provide arms and political support to Israel, regardless of the consequences. Remembering that there are devolved funding decisions involved here, what is the First Minister's response to this crisis, and will he join us in calling for de-escalation and for the UK government to end its complicity in war crimes being inflicted on Palestinians and others?
First Minister.
Presiding Officer, I share the deep concern that Patrick Harvey has expressed to Parliament today about the situation in the Middle East, because the calls that my predecessor and I have made for a ceasefire in Gaza for some considerable time, back to probably late October of last year, have essentially demonstrated that the calls that we made then were highlighting the fact of the danger of escalation of this conflict, and that is exactly what is now happening. So if there had been intervention to deliver a ceasefire a long time ago, we could have avoided being on the very dangerous course that we are now on. And I reiterate my call for there to be an immediate ceasefire and for all parties of goodwill to exercise their influence and responsibility to ensure that a ceasefire is brought about and there is a de-escalation of the conflict in the Middle East. All of this, of course, goes back to the atrocities that were committed by Hamas in early October 2023. All hostages should be returned, and there should be the application of a ceasefire to resolve these issues and the development of a two-stage solution to ensure that Palestinians can live in safety in their own sovereign, independent nation. Now, Mr. Harvey raises with me issues of devolved responsibility, and he and I had an exchange about this on the 30th of May 2024, and I reread that exchange this morning to satisfy myself that all steps that we can take within our legal responsibility are being taken to ensure that the concerns that Mr. Harvey puts to me are properly pursued.
Patrick Harvey.
There is a responsibility on all governments to act in the face of so much violence and destruction. And I welcome the fact that the First Minister has repeated his call for ceasefire, for de-escalation and for statehood for Palestine. I hope he continues to oppose the sale of arms to Israel. But the Greens have repeatedly raised the track record of the Scottish Government in giving grants to the companies that are producing those weapons and are profiting from the killings. Tens of thousands of people have been killed, and yet companies that are arming Israel have received hundreds of thousands of pounds from Scottish enterprise. The First Minister repeatedly defends this by saying his government doesn't fund the manufacture of munitions, but this is not the point. The government is funding the companies that profit from these atrocities. Will the First Minister finally send a clear signal today by immediately banning these companies from receiving grants and supports from the Scottish Government?
First Minister.
Presiding Officer, I understand why Patrick Harvey puts that question to me, and I understand the basis and the substance of the point that he puts to me. But what I said back on the 30th of May 2024 was that, and I quote from the official record, we have to have a legal basis for saying, for matters that are not related to Israel-Gaza conflict, that we are not providing a grant. And that is the key legal test that the government has got to satisfy, because the government, whatever else is happening in the world, this government has got to act within the law, and it will act under the law under my leadership, because I believe fundamentally in the rule of law in all circumstances. It would help if many other people believed in the rule of law as well in resolving some of these issues. So I don't in any way dismiss the points that Patrick Harvey puts to me, but I simply say that I have to act within the law, and I will explore once again, as I've assured him, and I will keep this under review as to whether there are any actions we can take which will properly address our legal responsibilities, but also address the moral and ethical issues that Mr Harvey fairly puts to me this afternoon.
Question number 4 has been withdrawn. Question number 5, Brian Whittle.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the First Minister, in light of the recent reports of an increase in alcohol-related deaths in Scotland, what steps the Scottish Government is taking to reduce excessive drinking?
First Minister.
Presiding Officer, the recent statistics are a stark reminder of the challenge our nation faces in tackling alcohol harm. The increase of minimum unit pricing of alcohol to 65 pence per unit this week is an example of concrete action taken by this government to prevent alcohol harm. Research estimated that our policy saved hundreds of lives and likely averted hundreds of alcohol-attributable hospital admissions compared to what would have happened without minimum unit pricing in place. To support people already drinking at hazardous and harmful levels, the Scottish Government provided a sustained record investment of £112 million to alcohol and drug partnerships this year.
Brian Whittle.
Can I thank the First Minister for that response? I think whether we agree with the effectiveness of minimum unit pricing or not, I think we will agree that it's certainly not going to be a silver bullet. Presiding Officer, many people caught in excessive drinking or addiction are self-medicating to counter other traumas. If we are to effectively tackle the scourge of that addiction in Scotland, we need to recognise not only the right to recovery advocated by the Scottish Conservatives, we need to work to prevent others falling into that addiction. So does the First Minister recognise that community activities such as youth clubs and sports clubs and music and drama and the Scouts and the Guides and all those great organisations can also be a positive alternative form of self-medication? And if he does, does he further recognise that by reducing access to the activities both in schools and the community, by closing facilities and squeezing third sector funding, makes preventing addiction that much more difficult?
First Minister.
There's a lot in Mr Whittle's question with which I agree, that there is the opportunity to have a fulfilling life that does not require any resort to alcohol or drug dependency can often be delivered by participation in many of the organisations and activities that Mr Whittle puts to me. And I can assure him, and I very much practice this in my parliamentary and ministerial activities, very strong support for the work of the third sector and many of the organisations that Mr Whittle talks about. I suppose the only note of discord I have to say is that we've got to find the money somewhere. And I keep on coming back to this point, that it's all very well for members of Parliament to come here and ask us to fund things and to fund other provision, with which I think is totally valuable, to find the resources for that without supporting us in having the means to do so. Now, Mr Whittle's party were responsible for the chaos in our public finances with which we wrestle, and the government is working our way through those challenges. But I simply appeal to Mr Whittle to follow through his commitment to encourage me to support these organisations and these activities by then supporting us and having the means to invest in these organisations through the budget process.
Colette Stevenson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Would the First Minister agree that the minimum unit pricing on alcohol has already proven itself, given that Public Health Scotland and the University of Glasgow analysis estimates that the policy has reduced alcohol deaths by 13.4% and hospital admissions by 4.1%, and in addition to innovative policies like minimum unit pricing, can the First Minister outline the actions the Scottish Government is taking to support people seeking treatment for alcohol-related issues?
First Minister.
President Officer, I very much agree with Colette Stevenson that minimum unit pricing has been effective. There's recent commentary in The Lancet, which was a contribution by internationally renowned public health experts, that stated, and I quote, that policymakers can be confident that there are several hundred people who are alive today as a result of minimum unit pricing. Now, that's something that I think we should all welcome as the effectiveness of policy. But it's not the only instrument of policy that we have. On alcohol treatment, the government has made available £112 million to alcohol and drug partnerships. And we have made £100 million available, or we will do over the course of this parliament, to increase access to residential rehabilitation. And we'll work with stakeholders to create a new national service specification alongside guidance for alcohol treatment to try to address these issues.
Carol Mockin.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The World Health Organisation estimates that more than half of children in Scotland have tried alcohol before they turn 13. What progress is the Government making on this issue? And will the First Minister commit to pursuing with some urgency policies that deliver an alcohol-free childhood?
Minister.
I agree fundamentally with the point that Callum Mockin puts to me, and the Government is of course taking forward a number of measures under consultation in relation to alcohol marketing, which is designed to achieve the objective that Callum Mockin understandably puts to me today. So I reassure her that that is part of the Government's programme to put in place the measures which avoid children having exposure to alcohol in their childhood to enable us to have more positive outcomes for those young people.
Question number 6, Pam Duncan-Glancy.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the First Minister what the Scottish Government's position is regarding whether teachers are essential to raising educational attainment and closing the poverty-related attainment gap.
First Minister.
Presiding Officer, Scotland's teachers are vital to driving improvements in our schools, raising attainment and closing the poverty-related attainment gap. It's for that reason that we are providing local authorities with £145.5 million in this year's budget to protect teacher numbers, and why I and the Education Secretary are committed to working with our local authority partners to ensure the best possible education for every child in Scotland.
I'm Duncan Glancy.
I thank the First Minister for that answer, but he'll know that not a single local authority has agreed to receive that funding. The First Minister says he believes that teachers are essential. His Cabinet Secretary says that she can't raise attainment with fewer teachers, yet 450 in Glasgow began losing their jobs. By what the First Minister just said himself, these jobs are essential. Teachers are working on average 11 hours extra, unpaid, every week. And on this Government's watch, new teachers can't get jobs. Enough is surely enough. That's why Parliament voted for my motion for the Government to intervene in this, save the jobs and bring forward a proper plan. But once again, the Government ignored the will of this Parliament. So can I ask the First Minister today, when will teachers have the stability they deserve?
First Minister.
I think the teaching profession is fundamental to our education system in Scotland. I saw that firsthand when I was Education Secretary, and I reiterate what I've put on the record today, that teachers play a critical role in the achievement of the Government's objectives on education. It's for that reason that we are making available the resources to protect teacher numbers. Pam Duncan-Glancy said to me that local authorities haven't yet agreed to accept that money. Well, a way of stabilising the teaching profession would be for local authorities to agree to accept the money that the government has put on the table. That would be the simplest way to take things forward. And I would think that would be something that would help local authority financing by having the certainty from the government about investing in the teaching profession, which has always been our priority. I'm very pleased that we've got to a situation where the teaching profession has accepted the pay offer that has been made through the SGNC, that provides further stability for the teaching profession, which continues the position of the teaching profession about being the best paid teaching profession in the United Kingdom.
Emma Harper.
First Minister, Labour members time and again come to this chamber to demand more spending while at the same time standing behind Keir Starmer and Rachel Reeves' austerity agenda. So does the First Minister agree with me that it's vital that the UK budget commits to investment rather than austerity, and that it is for all parties to join with the SNP in making that case to the UK Government?
First Minister, I am not entirely clear that that question related to the substantive question on the paper. I will therefore call Liam Kerr.
Very grateful, Presiding Officer. Teaching jobs instability extends to supply teacher posts. Now, recent figures from the Scottish Teachers for Permanence campaign suggest 80% of supply teachers have had little or no supply work this year. And in some councils, over 60% had less than a month. Now, taken with Pam Duncan Glancy's statistics, this all paints a picture of job insecurity, negative impact on pupil experience, financial uncertainty, and little encouragement for those seeking to join the profession. So can the First Minister provide Parliament with a published strategy to address the teacher recruitment and retention crisis, or is his government making it up as they go along?
First Minister.
Well, as Mr Kerr will know, teachers are employed by individual local authorities. And well, if we've now got to the point that the Conservative Party groans when statement of fact are put on the record, the Conservative Party is in a pretty dismal position. So
let's hear one another.
Local authorities employ teachers, and the government works with local authorities on workforce planning, because all of these factors are taken into account when it comes to the setting of the admission levels into initial teacher education, which is a collaboration between the government and local authorities, which is the point I was going to make before the groaning started from the Conservative benches. So that is the workforce planning that is undertaken within Scotland to make sure that we have a sufficient supply of qualified teachers to contribute to the education profession. So that's the work that's undertaken. I'll ask the Education Secretary to reflect on whether there's further refinements are required in the light of Mr Kerr's question. But we do undertake workforce planning because it informs the admission to initial teacher education, which is critical to make sure we have all the skills necessary for our teaching profession in Scotland.
Thank you. We move to constituency and general supplementaries, and I call Ben McPherson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Over recent weeks, a number of constituents have contacted me regarding concerning incidents that have taken place on Scottish Government-owned land in Granton. Most worryingly, a fire was started that damaged a substation and left local residents without an electricity supply for many hours. The land is designated for an exciting new development by National Gallery Scotland, which I hope will proceed soon. In the meantime, however, my constituents and I would be grateful if the First Minister and colleagues could quickly consider how the Scottish Government can take more action to secure the land to reduce risk, criminality and antisocial behaviour in the area.
First Minister.
Sir, I understand the concerns that Mr McPherson raises on behalf of his constituents, and I give him the assurance that we will do all that we can to encourage the securing of this particular site. We'll work very closely with the City of Edinburgh Council and Police Scotland to identify solutions to the challenges that are faced in the Granton area. As Mr McPherson knows, the project for the National Galleries is an important commitment on the Government's behalf, and we look forward to taking the necessary steps to secure that site in advance of the development of that particular site.
Oliver Mundell.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. As part of Dyslexia Awareness Week, Dyslexia Scotland and the University of Glasgow yesterday published a hard-hitting research project looking at the experience of 1,400 adults with dyslexia. The report highlights a number of areas of concern, including challenges in obtaining an adult assessment without formal education. 80% of participants said this cost to getting this assessment was preventing them from having their dyslexia identified, and three quarters said it was negatively impacting them in the workplace. These concerns have been raised numerous times before with little progress. So will the First Minister agree to meet with Dyslexia Scotland and a cross-party group of MSPs to discuss the findings? And will he finally agree that the Scottish Government should fund these important assessments for all adults?
First Minister.
Sir, I'm familiar with the research that Mr Mundell puts to me, and I acknowledge the significance of the issue of dyslexia where that is not identified and not supported as a consequence. So I'm very happy to agree to meet with Mr Mundell and with Dyslexia Scotland. I've had engagement with the organisation in the past, and I would welcome a continuation of that dialogue. Obviously, there are financial implications of putting in place of meeting the costs of the assessments that Mr Mundell puts to me, but we will have those discussions and identify what further actions the government can take to support the legitimate aspirations that Mr Mundell puts to me.
Jackie Bailey.
The First Minister will be aware of my constituent who died last week in an industrial accident in Southampton. His death will be subject to a coroner's inquest, which will be months away, and an interim death certificate is issued by the coroner as a matter of course. But legislation passed here in 2015 only allows full death certificates to be accepted for burials and cremations in Scotland. So my constituent cannot be brought home for burial or cremation, which obviously compounds his family's distress. Can I thank the Health Secretary for his positive engagement on this issue? But can I ask the First Minister, what can he do to resolve this matter urgently? And will he specifically consider whether Health Improvement Scotland, who provide a death certification review service, can act in this case?
First Minister.
Sir, I'm familiar with this case, and first of all, I want to say that I sympathise very much with the family involved, and I understand that this circumstance will just add to the distress that they are suffering. Jackie Bailey received a reply from the Health Secretary last night on this question, and I do assure her that we are in touch with the relevant authorities to try to find a way through this, to try to resolve the issue. I don't have a solution as yet, but I assure her that we are actively working to try to ensure that is the case and to do it as swiftly as we possibly can do.
Bob Doris.
Presiding Officer, on the 27th of September, the Afghan embassy in the UK closed, leaving 280,000 strong Afghan diaspora in the UK, including constituents of mine and families across Scotland, without consular services such as passport facilities, which enable travel. For the avoidance of doubt, Presiding Officer, the consular services were provided by a small and committed staff team who remained loyal to the now toppled democratically elected government and who rejected the Taliban completely. This closure will have a detrimental impact on many families who have made their lives and homes here in Scotland. Can I ask the First Minister to make direct representations to the UK Government to see how they may be able to support the reopening of the embassy and with it the restoration of consular services?
First Minister.
Sir, I appreciate the difficulty that Mr Doris puts to me, and I'm very happy to confirm that we will make representations to the United Kingdom Government on that basis to see what can be achieved here. It's a deeply regrettable situation that the Afghan embassy faced closure following the dismissal of its staff by the Taliban government. Individuals should have access to representation by their government, and they should be supported in ensuring their needs are met. And I give Mr Doris the assurance that we will make those representations to the United Kingdom government to determine how these issues can be resolved. I would also make the point, since Mr Doris raises this issue with me about the Afghan population in Scotland, that their contribution to our country is deeply valued. They are citizens who are welcome here, and we want to do everything that we can to ensure they can contribute to our society and they can be well supported in so doing.
Pam Gossel.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Police officers from across Scotland have been holding a silent demonstration in front of the Parliament this morning, with many officers currently in the gallery. Years of brutal cuts from the Scottish Government had left hard-working police officers doing their jobs with one hand tied behind their back. As a consequence, police officer numbers are at their lowest since 2007. Therefore, I would like to ask the First Minister if he recognises that police officers feel undervalued and overworked, and will he commit to a fair pay deal in line with other public sector workers?
First Minister.
Presiding Officer, I am very happy to put on the record that I value enormously the contribution made by police officers to our lives in Scotland. They are essential contributors to the safety of members of the public, and they provide a pivotal and essential role that is highly valued by me as First Minister and by the Scottish Government. Police pay is negotiated through two separate processes, the Police Negotiating Board for Scotland for officers and the Joint National Consultative Committee for staff. Pay claims have now been submitted for both police officers and police staff and will be progressed through the relevant negotiating processes, and it's therefore that process will resolve the issues that Pam Gosol puts to me. Our police officers in Scotland have consistently been the best paid in the United Kingdom at the minimum and the maximum of each rank. This recognises the hard work and the valuable contribution they make daily, as well as our commitment to investing in policing. And on police numbers, there is recruitment underway just now, which is designed to boost police numbers. And of course, the statistics on that will be published in due course.
Sarah Boyack.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the First Minister, in the light of the disruption arising from the closure of the Princess Alexandra Eye Pavilion for the next 6 months, can the First Minister confirm what financial support the Scottish Government has committed to provide to NHS Lothian to ensure that no patient loses out now and in the future?
First Minister.
I understand the significance of the issue that Sarah Boyack puts to me. The Health Secretary has been actively engaged on this issue, and there will be a briefing to Members of Parliament tomorrow on the subject. We are in discussion with NHS Lothian about the arrangements to ensure the continuity of service to individuals that will be affected by the closure because of the structural issues that we have to confront. And the Health Secretary will keep Members of Parliament updated about the steps being taken to make sure the concerns that Sarah Boyack puts to me are properly and fully addressed.
Willie Rennie.
Almost two-thirds of teachers surveyed in Fife are considering leaving the profession as a result of violence in schools. So what can the First Minister say to those teachers to keep them teaching, and what precisely has changed as a result of the recently published government guidance on behaviour?
First Minister.
I think the first thing is to say that I understand the concerns of members of the teaching profession, and those concerns are taken seriously within the government. That's why we brought forward the proposals and the mechanisms that were available to the teaching profession at the start of the school year. The Education Secretary announced all of those changes. There are now a greater range of responsibilities and opportunities for the teaching profession to be exercised by the teaching profession to ensure that schools remain safe places for all, which they should be in all circumstances. Local authorities have been part of the process of formulating those proposals, and they are obviously, as the employers of teachers, available to support teachers in exercising the responsibilities that they need to exercise to keep schools safe.
Emma Roddick.
It is vital that we continue to take action to tackle the housing emergency, and the £22 million investment this week into the Charitable Bronze Programme to increase investment in affordable homes will play an important role in this. Can the First Minister outline the impact of the UK Government's savage cut to the availability of the type of funding known as financial transactions on the Scottish Government's wider ability to invest in housing under the limited powers of devolution?
Minister.
So the specific point on financial transactions is very important for the Affordable Housing Supply Programme budget, because we experienced a 62% cut to financial transactions by the last United Kingdom government. Now, this financial mechanism was crucial in enabling the affordable housing programme to be sustained at the previous level, and it has largely accounted for the falls in investment that's available. Now, we've made representations to the United Kingdom government. I've raised this with both the Chancellor and the Deputy Prime Minister to secure a change to that approach, and we will get the answer to that point in the budget on the 30th of October. But what I would say to Emma Roddick is that these investment streams are absolutely crucial to enabling us to sustain our investment in affordable housing, but the government is also deploying innovation to ensure that some of the other mechanisms that we've developed on charitable bonds or the work that's now in place in relation to the negotiation around providing financial support to bring void properties back into use, it demonstrates some of the flexibility that we are trying to put in place to address the housing challenges that we face around Scotland.
Douglas Lumsden.
Presiding Officer, it is now over 3 years since the SNP government announced a review into the duelling of the A96. The review is nearly 2 years late, and their delay in tactic has cost taxpayers almost £6 million. On Friday, an air ambulance had to be called to yet another harrowing collision just outside Huntley. So can the First Minister stop playing political games with people's lives and tell us when the review will finally be published?
First Minister.
The government has made clear our commitments in relation to the A96, including duelling the A96 between Inverness and Nairn and the Nairn bypass. And there is a review underway in relation to the remainder of the route. That will be concluded in due course, and Parliament will be advised of its implications. The government is committed to ensuring that we take measures to address road safety in all parts of the country. The Transport Secretary is focused on those measures and has put in place a range of practical steps to ensure that that is the case.
Thank you. That concludes First Minister's questions. The next item of business is a member's business debate in the name of Katie Clark, and there will now be a short suspension to allow those leaving the chamber and the public gallery to do so.